Hi everyone, my name is James Feeney. Welcome to or back to my channel. Today I want to talk about the differences and similarities of reading tarot or tarot cards and playing cards. So these are both systems of card reading and divination. In many ways, structurally, they do resemble each other. So for me, as somebody who has been more recently, studying playing card divination and the use of playing cards for readings, I've come across, I would say, very distinctive attributes that I would associate with playing cards versus tarot cards. And to me, the two are almost like two entirely different beasts, but at the same time, they're like cousins in a lot of ways as well, and I just thought it would be fun to share my own thoughts on how the two are related to each other or dissimilar in some ways. If you are interested in card reading at all and just like a nice little ramble and comparative sort of dive into the cards, this might be fun for you. And if you've been debating maybe getting into playing card divination or tarot, this might be a fun one to just watch and listen to. So in my recent times, I would say reading playing cards, many of us are familiar with the structure. We've got ace through 10 and a court system, which is something that is also present in the tarot cards. Of course, in tarot, we also have a page, or if we're looking to the Thoth system, we have a princess. So there's another court card added in tarot that is not in playing cards. So the courts are more balanced, I would say, in tarot versus the three court cards in playing cards, which is a little bit unbalanced, especially toward the more masculine or active side. So that's just part of its lineage and history, whereas the tarot, which is a little bit more recent in history and lineage and was kind of derived with different purposes and means in mind, has a more balanced system of courts based on what I've read and why that has maybe taken place or transpired over time. And then of course we've got the major arcana in tarot that's not present in playing cards. So the deck is smaller. I would say, based on what I've read, it seems to actually mirror or resemble the lunar year quite well in terms of having 54 cards and the amounts of weeks. And I would say just the lunar cycles, it fits quite closely with the lunar year or the cycles of the year. So if you are more of a spiritualist who is very natural, who follows the wheel of the year, you might actually find a lot of benefit in working with playing cards, as they can sort of connect to that and the seasons and the aspects and times of year. Of course, there are jokers, but without the jokers, we have fewer cards, and that's more, it's kind of closer to accurate, I would say, in terms of the wheel of the year. Those are some very minor differences structurally, but I really want to talk about the feeling I get from them and why I would use one versus the other. I think that's something that's really important, because when we pick up the cards, we're looking to them for guidance or to use them for something. There's a reason, and depending on that reason, we may choose one deck or over the other, one form of divination over the other. And I've spoken a bit to the idea that playing cards to me are more folky in some ways. There's something about them that's more, I would say, raw and less refined. It's a lot more natural and fluid. There isn't as much of a hard and fast structure. There aren't as many rules with playing card divination. There's not as many, I would say, meanings and connotations that are well agreed upon. So there isn't a consensus or a canon in terms of playing cards and their meanings. And that's part of what makes them so fun and different from tarot. Tarot being a little bit more structured in its approach, despite the fact that there are multiple systems of tarot, we can, as a whole, depending on the system, and even outside of just the very specific systems, for the most part, agree generally on meanings of each card or traditional meanings of each card. That's something that we can find in books that most books may speak of differently and take their own creative liberties, but that we are ultimately going to arrive at something somewhat similar when we're looking to learn each of the meanings of these tarot cards. So it makes a learning process that is more regimented possible, whereas with playing cards, learning in a regimented way where you're expecting to be able to fall back on traditional meanings that are agreed upon throughout history, that's not possible. So a lot of the work that's done and a lot of the readings that you might find on playing cards are going to differ a lot more wildly than I think tarot books will. Although there are more tarot books out there that speak to things in different ways, I'm speaking mostly to the core of a card's meaning when used in divination. Now, the idea of the tarot as something that can be esoteric is something that has a really firm grip, I would say, on its history. When we look at older Marseille decks and things of that nature, the esoteric elements haven't really come into play yet. And so in that way, you might, and I might, think that a Marseille deck mirrors a playing card deck a lot more closely. One, because the pips are not illustrated in the same way. They're both lesser illustrated pips, but also because there aren't as many overt, esoteric, consciously sort of added symbolisms and elements within an older Marseille deck. I think more occult sort of elements enter the fray with Type 2 Marseille. That's its own thing. We won't get too deep into that, but in my opinion, actually, Marseille is kind of like a hybrid of more modern tarot systems and playing card divination. So that's something I really find very interesting. The lesser illustrated pips give you less to go on visually, but they force you to maybe contend with abstract concepts and numbers where you are confronted with those sorts of things instead of being able to, I would say, find yourself in a scene or draw from a picture or an image. Playing cards, you really don't have that. You have to get very conceptual, theoretical, abstract with the idea of a number or a color. You have to do a lot with a little when it comes to playing cards, whereas with tarot, you get quite a lot and you can get away with doing only a little. And that to me is quite funny. You can pick up this grand scene, look at it for all of a minute and decide what it means for you. Whereas you might pick up a playing card and be confronted with very little, but have to spend quite a lot of time taking this little bit of information and turning it into something that's applicable for you. So I do find that with playing cards, more patience is required, and sometimes that patience pays off in terms of what you can get out of a reading. It's harder to be lazy when reading tarot, when reading playing cards, because the idea of pictures not really being present kind of siphons out or sifts out anybody that might just want to look at a pretty picture and divine without having to really give a lot of themselves over to the process. So you can't really be as lazy when doing this. I mean, you can get away with the idea of, oh, for stability, structure, we've got the spades, it's difficult, things like that. You can get away with doing things that way, of course you can, but I would say by and large it's harder to perform a playing card reading and really get on with it super quickly and not have to critically think about what it is you're looking at and how that could be transposed onto your life. Whereas with a picture, a lot of the work is kind of done for you in some ways, which is also why I find that the Marseille is sort of that hybrid. It does have the trumps, it does have the major arcana, which are quite scenic or at least offer elements. But even in the Marseille, that the trumps or major arcana are a lot more simplistic in their elements. It's not that it's rudimentary or reductive. It's more that the things that you're looking at are, I don't know, they're almost clean cut. It's just different. So there's that sort of hybrid balance of needing to look at this sort of thing and decide how that number or arrangement of a thing can affect your life. And segueing from the idea of needing to take your time more with playing cards because of the fact that you don't get a picture, I think they are a lot more practical. The major arcana, the greater mysteries, lend themselves really well to the idea of spiritual truths, of the sort of gnosis or cathartic experience that we can take a really, I would say, high level spiritual concept and then try to bring it back down into our mundane life to derive some meaning from it. Whereas a deck like this, a deck of playing cards where there are no major mysteries, major arcana, we don't really contend with these grandiose spiritual concepts and try to reduce them or distill something out of them. So it's really just kind of flipping things over. It's easier to look, I would say, at practical aspects, in my opinion, with playing cards. Things like the nitty-gritty of life, like making very literal decisions at work, at, I would say, in terms of relationships, about interactions and interpersonal relationships in life, or decision-making in terms of choices, very literal choices. Whereas, in my opinion, tarot lends itself a lot better to, I would say, more reflective readings that are spiritually minded, where we don't necessarily have to get anything super practical out of it or choice-oriented. We don't have to walk away from the tarot with the idea of, I would say, a very definitive action to take, or knowing that something is a certain thing. I think that the tarot asks more questions than it answers. That's my opinion. And as readers, we become familiar with the cards. We're able to take what they signify and relate it back to something that's mundane or practical, but it's almost like you're translating at that point. Whereas with playing cards, the initial sort of way it communicates doesn't need to be translated to something practical, in my opinion. It automatically is. It speaks in those terms. Whereas with tarot, we're taking something that's either abstract or spiritual, an idea, a feeling, and we're trying to make it practical. So we're almost playing sort of a bit of a translator, or we have to be almost bilingual in our image reading abilities to be able to read with the tarot and derive something out of it that feels very useful. I mean in terms of our daily life. But I do think that, for example, when looking to spiritual matters, things that are a little bit more heady or emotional, things that we can't necessarily explain or relate in words, things that are, I would say, more tied in with the idea of humanity being something that is not wholly physical. We have these ideas that exist outside of what is necessary. We have emotions that don't make sense in a very practical way that we can't necessarily speak to. We have desires and we do things for fun, things that don't necessarily relate to anything that's practical or helpful to us. All of those sorts of things the tarot is great for, because those things sort of are slightly removed and more attached to the idea of what it means to be a human being versus a practical, or I would say, instinctual animal. And of course, in some ways, we are animals. We are physical. We have all of the same parts as many animals in the world. We're not so different. But I do think that the parts of us that maybe are a bit different as human beings can be looked at really well through the tarot, versus those more, you almost think like the reptile brain, the instinctual brain, fight and flight, and the on Maslow's hierarchy of needs, those basic needs of food, shelter, and all of those sorts of things, I think can be covered in a lot more of an effective way through playing card divination. And I don't think that either one is exclusive in their camp of way to be read or usefulness. I think that, of course, like I said, we can take the tarot and we can find ways to translate it into things that are quite practical for us, in the same way that I could take playing cards and find something spiritual in what it's saying. But like I said before, it's like translating. So taking, for example, the Eight of Diamonds, and right away my mind thinks of things that are more practical when I see this. And if I wanted to think of it spiritually, I would have to think of something almost more mundane first, and then try to find something spiritual or beautiful or magical in this mundane thing, or this very, very real world aspect, if that makes sense. So those are the biggest differences that I've found as a reader in studying playing card divination versus tarot, a system that I'm very established with. I'd be very curious to know what others think, if you are maybe debating or have some experience with playing cards, what the major differences you find are between tarot and playing card divination. If you like to experiment and are familiar with other forms and systems of divination, like geomancy, pyromancy, scrying, dowsing, pendulum divination, I would love to know how you either compare or can contrast it to tarot or other systems of divination, and what sort of feeling it gives you, or when it's most useful, or what it's best suited for. Because these, like anything, are tools. I turn to my tools for a certain purpose, and so I like to have a really awesome toolkit that I can turn to and find. For example, I don't want to use a screwdriver when I need a hammer, and I don't want to have to use a hammer to screw in a nail. I'd rather use something that's well suited for the job at hand. And in discovering, reading about, learning playing card divination, it feels like I've added a tool to my arsenal, to my toolkit that I can use for something that maybe I was using a different tool for, but that wasn't suited for that specific purpose. So let me know your thoughts on this. These were just my musings. This is really just a rambling video that I'm making for fun and something that I can also reflect on, and hopefully you can get others out there thinking. Like and subscribe if this was fun or interesting. I hope you are all well, and until next time, bye.